with Sarah Bukulis, local democracy reporter, and lots going on this week in the committees, Sarah. So we're going to start off with the Children, Young People and Skills Committee. Is there a special meeting taking place in regards to schooling?
Yes, there is. This is quite exciting because there has been this massive campaign by parents, particularly at four of the city schools. There were seven schools that were earmarked to have their admissions cut. And then the papers came out last Tuesday saying that the committee, for this special committee meeting this week, that they're not going to cut them. And this has been in sort of like four years, the schools have had their admissions cut because there is going to be a surplus of 1,000 places. Now, I spoke with a couple of parents who were very heavily involved with the campaign, and they were so thrilled that they won. Because what's happened with these particular schools is when the councillors looked at the data, they found that they're pretty good at managing their budgets. A lot of them have children with special needs. Two of them have specialist provision. You've got Carden that has the speech and language therapy. Bevendean has the hearing impairment centre, the launch pad. And these are really special, helpful schools. The problem is they're small, and that's why they got targeted. A lot of the parents said, why are they targeting us, not the big schools? They did the big schools last year and they appealed successfully. Now, what is disappointing is with the whole campaign, more than 4,000 people roughly signed the petitions to support these schools, but 412 people took part in the consultation. So it would have been nicer to have had maybe a couple of thousand, but I suppose 412, you have to accept that. But what the papers are saying going before the councillors are things like, Carden has a very high number of children with sibling link, and that could leave children in the area without a place. Coldean, which is on the list, they didn't campaign very vocally. They're quite isolated. They've also got a whole load of homes being built almost over the road from the school field in Coldean Lane, more than 200 homes. That is going to impact on them. If they have their numbers reduced, then where are these kids going to go? Because it's quite Coldean, it's out there on its own. Again, Bevendean, they were saying there is no viable alternative if their school gets oversubscribed. And in Woodingdean, they're the same, isolated, out there on the edge of the city, two very popular schools with growing numbers. A lot of people are moving, younger couples are moving out of the city centre and to Woodingdean because A, it's cheaper, and B, it's a much more pleasant environment to raise your family. You can go from a flat to a house. You're out there on the edge of the countryside, but you're still not far from everything else as well. So that is sort of, it was all part of this much bigger picture. But this is going to cause a problem in the long term because we've got all of these excess places and schools get their funding based on the number of children. It is bums on seats for these head teachers. And they really campaigned during the last period, the last couple of months where we've had parents choosing their schools for September for their reception age children. It's just like a massive PR campaign. Come to our school, we're fabulous, and we have this and we have that. And a lot, because I'm a parent and also because I follow the council, people do say to me, what are the best schools in Brighton? We're very lucky. We have got just loads of really brilliant primary schools. But not each school is suited to each child. Some children will thrive in a larger school. Some children need more outdoor space. Some want a smaller school. And that is all that is available. But we're going to hear what the councillors have to say about the consultation to this week. And it'll be very interesting. But there are a lot of really happy parents out there at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, it does have implications. But the can's really been kicked down the road then, hasn't it? That's essentially what's happened. And do you know the reason behind this kind of U-turn?
As far as I'm aware, it is because the schools put a really good case to not having their numbers reduced because there is the level of isolation, the way their budgets are well used. If you do lose a class from one of these schools, then you are likely to end up with a load of kids who are sent much further away from home.
Yeah.
And that is one of the key problems. In the future, we may see a situation where a school might need to close because there just aren't enough children to make it viable. But that's a long way down the road for the council schools. But I have looked at the numbers, and there are three of the church schools that have extremely low numbers, but the council has no influence on those. They are controlled by the two dioceses, Chichester and Arundel and Brighton. So I think there might have to be some hard discussions with the Church of England and the Catholic Church about those schools.
Yeah. Moving on to full council then. So what's happening exactly? Because, you know, football stadiums are meeting in full, aren't they? Have a, you know, kind of restrictions have been relaxed across the board, really, particularly in England. But what's happening at council level? Because I know there's been varying views given about, you know, how people are getting back to working for Brighton Hove City Council, but also the councillors themselves not going back to how things were pre-pandemic.
Well, all the committees are still meeting as they were, but there are 10 of them. They meet in the town hall chamber, the Hove Town Hall chamber. There is a lot of space, and the officers are all involved virtually.
Yeah.
Now, Hove Town Hall, if you put all 54 councillors in Hove Town Hall, it is quite tight. And the town hall chamber has a number limit on it at the moment of 36 people. And there was quite a debate last week with the leading councillors. You had Steve Bell from the Conservatives, Baillie McCafferty chairing, and John Alcock for Labour. And they were discussing about the full council meeting that's taking place this week. And what they've agreed is to have proportionally divided up 14 councillors. Now, we've still got the separate public engagement session. So that is all of your public questions, the petitions, deputations, members' questions. That is all going to be done virtually. All councillors can attend that. And one of the things that the Executive Director for Governance, People and Resources, the council's legal chief, Abraham Gabri Georgius, said was that Brighton has a very lively level of democratic engagement, and there are more questions, more petitions and deputations and councillor questions and motions than any other local authority he knows of. Now, he's very involved with the local government lawyers associations. You know, he's very respected nationally. So he knows, he knows from that side how successful Brighton and Hove is with engaging with the public. As a local democracy reporter, I talk to other local democracy reporters around the country. They're always amazed that I've got public questions at every single committee and expect to have at least an hour and a half of public engagement on Thursday. They're like, what, you have people coming, asking questions? But yes, the city is very involved.
Yes.
So I often feel that that aspect of the full council meeting is almost the most important, because it's the listening time. It's the time when people get to air their grievances with the council and get an answer, get something done. And the latter part, the full council meeting, is much more formal. So it often can turn into a bit of a bum fight where the various political groups decide to have a pop at each other. But what they're doing is they're going to be decision making and voting on things. They have to physically, legally be there in person. I've had people say to me, well, why can't they just all be virtual and some of them in there? That's not legal. That all ended last April. And there are councillors who are clinically vulnerable. There is one councillor I know who is just not attending meetings at all because they are terrified of potentially catching COVID. And I know through a number of meetings in the last couple of months, I've sat there with a councillor who doesn't know they have COVID and then finds out later, still clear here, but sore throat anyway. What we don't have in Brighton and Hove is a cabinet system where an executive councillor can make a decision, just one person. We've got committees, they've got political balance.
Yeah.
There's no overall control. Everyone gets a voice. And that is a good thing because it's all the representatives of the city. So what's coming up are items that have been referred to the full council from committees. So there's already been a debate through the various political groups, and they are going to vote on those. These are sort of quite big items that they feel the council should have its say on. And there's also some new motions. Now, a lot of the motions, the ideas that councillors bring forward, have been going straight to the committees so that they get the full political debate there. Some of them really don't belong in a committee and are more of a council thing. So that's the stuff that's coming up on Thursday. So the actual formal council point meeting is probably going to be a lot shorter than it usually is. It can often run to about 3 or 4 hours, but we'll have the public engagement that could, it's been allocated an hour and a half, but it could go on to 2 hours. The last meeting was more than three. There you go. And that was just public engagement.
Yeah, exactly. So, and then what happens to the rest of the council? So it's just going to be 14 councillors then for the full council meeting. And how are they going to be elected?
It is proportional through each group. So the largest group will be the Greens, then Labour, then the Conservatives, and there will also be some independents. I haven't got the numbers down with me, but they were listed. So it is all sort of proportionally divided up, because that is only fair.
Brilliant. We'll leave it there. Let's join you again, Sarah, for the second half shortly. Join us then. Back here with Sarah Booker Lewis, and Sarah, we're going to crack on and talk about the King Alfred and about kind of an update on facilities down at the King Alfred. I haven't swam there for a long time, but I'm told they've still got the bridge from the 1990s there at the swimming pool.
I think it wasn't it the 80s. I remember going down there when I was at school for swimming time.
Yeah,
and I actually do remember the old King Alfred freezing cold, gripping onto the white tiles at the side. Yeah. Apparently, they're still underneath the sports hall. I've seen photos. It's still there in my mind. Yes, now this is another public question that is coming up at full council this week. A woman who's doing sea swimming training, the pool to pier, and she went down to the King Alfred and she was absolutely shocked at the state of it. I mean, to be honest, it is looking pretty sad. I do remember when it was brand new with the little islands in the walk-in lagoon area. And yes, the bridge is still there, but there are tiles coming off the wall and it really is past its life. So this woman is asking, what is being done to replace these facilities? Because they really are completely out of date. Now, the last development, the Star Trust and Chris Nicholson £228 million project, that collapsed at the end of 2019.
And of course,
since then, the focus has gone elsewhere. There's been kind of this big focus on COVID, dealing with the pandemic response, and everything has gone on hold. Now, the Star Trust, when it all collapsed, they were in talks with Legal & General because Legal & General are doing a lot of build-to-rent projects. In the New England area, that's going up at the moment. That's one of their projects. So that is a potential, but yes, the council has already put out its leisure thing and they know that they need a new swimming pool. We need a new swimming pool in the city centre because, to be honest, the Prince Regent is pretty ancient as well. I think, what, is it 42 years old? I was at primary school when that opened. Yeah. And yeah, they're both pretty ancient. I know a lot of people enjoy St. Luke's. That's being kept as it is, but that's more of a sort of traditional swimming experience. We do need something fresh. So it will be interesting to see what is said about this when it comes up.
Yeah. Virgin Active as well, private swimming pools. I mean, a new swimming pool is David Lloyd gym down Marina, but Virgin Active has closed as well. So actually swimming facilities, even in the private sector, are diminishing as well.
Yes, I think the University of Brighton have taken over what was Virgin Active because they're moving all their sports services from Eastbourne over to Brighton and Hove. I have seen the Mulscombe community talking about whether or not they're going to have access to this, because I think apparently that has been promised. But whether or not there's going to be a swimming pool still there in the future is another matter. And then David Lloyd, you've got to pay for it, but apparently it's lovely.
Yeah, it is. Anyway.
Although there are... You can go into the hotel swimming pools. You can book in to those. And there is a private swimming pool that opens up to the public as well. But then you have to pay £50 for an hour in there. So it's not cheap.
Moving on, 5G masts on Dyke Road. There are quite a few up there, aren't there? Particularly at the top of Dyke Road. So people getting a bit concerned about that. So what can they do to stop it? Because I know there's also a lot of high buildings there that are also used for masts, aren't they?
Yes, the Army barracks that has got masts on the top. You can sort of see they look like little chimneys, but that's actually all fake, and that's covering the masts. Now, there is a petition that a community in that area have set up. They want to have what's called Article 4 restrictions, which are very specific restrictions on a set area that would prevent 5G masts in the Dyke Road area, particularly the triangle from the old Shoreham Road up to Dyke Road and going back as far as, I think, Hove Park Road as well.
Yeah.
And what they're concerned about the impact of these masts on the views. The park is a beautiful setting, and also the fact that you've got quite a few schools in the area. There was a massive mast put at the bottom of the upper drive, right on the edge of Cardinal Newman's grounds, just over the road from Brighton Girls and Cottesmore Primary School. So you've also got Basvic there. Over the other side of the road, there's Windlesham, Stamford. It's all very busy when it comes to kids. And then even further up, you've got Lancing College Prep as well off of Hove Park Road. So they want to have these specific restrictions saying no 5G masts in this area. There are people that are very concerned about 5G. I know when I've spoken to the campaigners, this is off an offshoot of the Park Lodge campaign, where the people who live there and actually the freeholders of Park Lodge, which is just behind the Esso garage, they said no to 5G masts. And that was basically foisted upon them. The companies, the phone companies, didn't actually ask them, the freeholders, the people that own the land, if they would be okay with having masts on top. They just said, right, we're going to have masts on top. So that's not the way to go about it.
Yeah.
People have been concerned about the health issues. I have explained to them that that is actually not a planning consideration.
Exactly.
Because the official line is there are no health issues, but people do still worry about it. So that may well come up when it is presented on Thursday.
Yeah. What about council tax reduction review? I mean, the council tax always seems to go up. I don't know about a reduction, but just tell us a bit about that.
Right. Yeah. Now, the council tax reduction is not for the likes of you and I. The Policy and Resources Committee, they have already agreed to have a £200,000 fund to support people who are not pensioners and don't claim universal credit, but are on the edge of losing, that they, if they lost their benefits, they would be in hardship. So it's based on earnings and living costs. So if you earn around less than £70 a week, you would only pay 18% of your council tax bill. And the highest amount is if you earn £240 a week, you get a 10% reduction in the bill. So people getting universal credit, they get the discount, and the council decided that they wanted to extend the reduction for people that just miss out on these support, these areas of support. Particularly, there are people who work, who claim universal credit, and their benefit figures go up and down depending on how much they earn. It depends how much they work in a week, and it really is something just to help people who are on the edge of poverty or extreme poverty, just to make sure that they keep their heads above water. And of course, this is all very much part of what's in the headlines at the moment about the increasing cost of living, and particularly the lower cost food items becoming more expensive, or just the value, the smart price type of items just disappearing from the shelves.
Yeah. So that's going to be a big thing. Another big thing, actually, is the sinkhole, isn't it, at the Old Steine. I've seen that. It's massive. I think it's 5 foot, if not more. And in the general state of the Old Steine and the Victoria Fountain, that whole area since the funfair has been there, it's not great, to be fair, is it? It looks a state.
No, it's a lot of, I know Victoria Gardens is all fenced off as it's all been reseeded and everything. Yeah. But yes, apparently you can't see the bottom of the sinkhole. Now, yeah. I did speak to one of the senior officers who said that it is not linked with the fair. To be honest, I think the fair probably didn't help with a lot of heavy equipment and machinery on that area that's not used to it. And it probably exacerbated an existing problem. But that's just my opinion, because those of us that know the Wellesbourne goes under there, the river.
Yeah,
it is. That's why the Valley Gardens area often does flood, because there is a river underneath all of that, and it likes to come up. Pool Valley is called Pool Valley for a reason. It used to be water. So it is something that needs to be looked at. It's probably going to impact on the festival because I can't imagine that this year the Spiegel tent can go there if you've got a massive hole. And apparently there are more dips appearing. So it looks like maybe the water table has risen and is eroding the top. And I think for a number of years now, people have noticed that the fountain is looking really quite wonky. So that, again, that's a very heavy item. It's been there, I think, throughout living memory now. I'm sure no one remembers a time when it wasn't there. And it's a beautiful thing. And we want the Victoria Fountain to stay. But if it's tilting and going to become dangerous, then something really needs to be done. That is coming up at full council this week. It's one of those motions that really needs a full council discussion. It will probably go forth to environment, transport and sustainability eventually, and maybe even tech as well, because tech, the tourism, equalities, communities and culture, that involves a lot of the areas around Old Steine, because we have so many events in that area and we need to protect it and make sure that it doesn't all fall into a massive hole.
Yeah, exactly. So that's going to come up. I know that is quite of concern. I spoke to Councillor Mary Mears about that. So it's going to be interesting. Now, moving on to planning, King George VI Drive, the Hove Valley application. What's the status there? I mean, this has been going on literally for decades. And I know that the Audi application got withdrawn and refused, didn't it? What about the housing?
I have heard that Toad's Hole Valley, they're now going to put in a planning appeal because it's their planning application was submitted in 2018. And it has changed because they haven't got a secondary school in there anymore because it's not needed.
We'll leave it there. Sarah, all the best. We'll catch up again next week. Thanks.